All right. Thank you all for sticking around. Great to be here. And I'm going to give you the story, I suppose, of Burnbeo Trust, which some of you might be familiar with and others maybe not so much. I'll give you the story, but also hopefully maybe some practical ideas in terms of the work that we've done and things that work for us that might be something that you could put into action wherever you are. And also, I think what we're doing and what I'll be talking about, a lot of people are doing similar things in other places. It's not that we've reinvented the wheel, but to some extent, I think part of what we've done is maybe put a framework around some of the ideas and maybe making them a little bit more cohesive. And it's interesting just hearing the last couple of speakers to hear the importance, obviously, of community engagement and also the importance of celebration and recognising work that has been done and festivals and that kind of an approach. So you'll see some of that in what we do. I am Education Communications Officer and, you know, I work a lot in local schools, and I've done a lot of research as well on a topic that I'll be touching on quite a bit, the idea of place-based learning and place-based education. So I'll give you a bit more about that. But just to start, I suppose, Burnbeo, we are an independent membership charity. And independent is great. It means we can do what we want, but it also means we've got very little money, because if we had state support, we'd probably be much better off. But anyway, we won't get too hung up on that. Membership, really important. So it indicates support from our local community, but it's local and international, businesses, schools, individuals, families. So, you know, there's quite a few different categories of people supporting us. And what we're about, dedicated to connecting all of us to our places and then helping identify our role in caring for these places. And obviously, there's a giveaway in the name. We are located in the Burren. We started in the Burren, and we were established originally, officially 10 years ago as a charity, to meet an identified need within the community. So it was looking at kind of building pride of place and sense of community in the Burren region. And I think that's important as well, to meet identified needs rather than to impose what we think people want or need in their places. We're quite a small team, 2.5 staff, but we do a lot, and we do a lot because we have come to a point now where we have devolved, basically. We coordinate, but it's carried out, it's community led. So we're just facilitation, we're kind of coordination support a lot of the time. 500 members, local, national, international, 100 active conservation volunteers. Again, it's a really key part of what we do. People actually getting out and doing something, and that functions on a number of different levels. It obviously has an impact in terms of actual conservation, but also volunteering, as a lot of people will be very aware, it's hugely beneficial to the people who are engaged in it as well. And then we've 10,000 or so people following us on various social media. One of the first questions we often get asked, so I'll just get it out of the way quickly, is how are you funded? And I could answer it in one word, which would be barely, but it's a mixture of different funding streams. We do apply and get grants from the Heritage Council, for which we're extremely grateful. And then we have a few other things going on, but we run everything on a not-for-profit, just try to cover our costs. So it's, you know, there are various different funding streams, and we're always looking at how we can kind of have a more sustainable, I suppose, funding model going forward. And in terms of actually what we're doing and why we're doing it, again, like I mentioned, maybe just putting terms around what you're already doing or building that framework. What we ultimately are trying to achieve is conservation, but conservation through community stewardship. So engaged communities that are actively involved in conservation of their place. So giving people the opportunity to know their place, to engage with it, and also to ask critical questions, deciding what they want their place to be like into the future. And how we do it is under this umbrella of place-based learning. Like I said, it's not, I'd love to be able to claim it as mine, but it isn't. There are many, mainly US-based academics who have been working on this as an idea for quite a while. But essentially it boils down to learning about place through place, which was the title that this piece was given. But actually what's really, really important is the for-place element. So it's not just using the place, it's also giving something back and thinking about how you want the place to be into the future. And this idea of stewardship, you know, it makes sense. It implies, you know, individual action. It requires people to what can be really key to it is to move beyond the adversarial responses. So sometimes, you know, you can be faced with huge challenges and they just seem, that's too big, we're not even going to go there, we're not going to try. But if you do empower and allow your community to engage, very often you'll find that, you know, people will take a little bit more ownership and have a direct impact on what's happening in their place. Because David Attenborough says it very well, and we quote him constantly, but essentially it comes down to no one will protect what they don't care about, and no one will care about what they've never experienced. So it's just about facilitating that experience and meeting people at their level, wherever that is, because sometimes some of the topics, heritage even in itself, can become quite elitist, and it's, you know, people are interested or they're not, and it's about how to engage the wider community to make it relevant and applicable to your entire community. And the reason that we're taking this approach, first of all, I suppose, is acknowledging that, that places are more than just bricks and mortar and plants and animals and so on. They are also places where people live, and places have an impact on us, and then we also impact them. So I'm not going to go too airy-fairy with you, but just to acknowledge that it's a place, it's a part of the environment, but there are feelings attached to it. So we have emotional attachments to place, and that it's more than just the bricks and mortar, like I said, which is why we look at place in its entirety. We look at landscape, nature, past, culture, and community at the centre, with all of these, our focus being conservation. So we say, you know, we're looking at built, natural, and cultural heritage, how they interact, and key and to the centre at all times is how it the community interact with it. So looking at that kind of holistic picture, it means that you hopefully are more likely to engage your community on a wider level, because people may have interests, very specific interests in one or other of these areas, but trying to make it applicable to everybody. And, you know, again, it's thinking about connection, connecting to place and how important it is. And it's that, you know, the classic of if you don't know where you are, you don't know who you are. But it, you know, research would indicate that possibly the disconnect is growing, that people don't have that strong connection. We're not as dependent on our local places for food, livelihoods, and so on. So we don't have that, you know, strong connection to place. But it is important. And, you know, there are studies there that would suggest that if we lose that local connection, the impacts are going to be kind of ripple out and go further than that, be pretty significant. But what I really like, I've been a little bit, there's a few negatives there. What I really like is, in terms of a place-based approach, it's empowering. Because if you start local, if you value local knowledge, you can give real experience, it's empowering. It moves you away from that adversarial response that we can do nothing and, you know, give up and go home. And it can start something that you know, the start local, act global, think local, act global. And, you know, we're seeing that in practice on the ground, which is really nice. The other really, really nice thing about place-based learning is that it can happen anywhere. So, you know, I sometimes would kind of have people turn around and say, oh, that's grand, you work in the Burren, it's easy for you, you've got an easy story to tell, and there's been a lot of work done there. But actually, everywhere has a story to tell. Every place, I don't need to tell you guys, has something that makes it unique, makes it interesting, and it's just trying to find that and trying to make it relevant to the people and interesting to the people of that place. And how we do it in the Burren, we deliver a series of different programmes, or we coordinate and facilitate others to deliver. But I'll just give you a run through of a few of the programmes that we do. And the first and possibly one of the highest impact programmes is a programme called Auchbio Primary. So Auchbio, in terms of living place that you live, but also a place that is living and evolving around us. And it's a free 10-week course that we deliver to local primary schools. It's our giving back to the region, an investment in the future with the future custodians, I suppose, of the region. It is entirely inquiry-based learning. It's not lecture top-down. I go into a classroom and from day one I say, look, I'm not the expert on your place. We're going to find out about our place together. And it's about building skills and tools so that these young people can learn the things that interest them about their place, but they can also then transfer that no matter where they are. So, and then encouraging that idea of active stewardship, they need to carry out some active stewardship project locally based on needs that they identify in their community. So, you know, there are the simple ones like the litter pick. They have developed biodiversity trails. They have written to the council about parking issues. It's very varied. It's a local issue that the children in that school see and want to take action on. We have over 1,200 graduates have gone through the programme at this stage. And what's really nice is we're now starting to meet them at secondary school and also meet them at third level. And they're coming back to us saying, you've no idea the impact that that programme had on me. I remember it. I know the names of the flowers, the monuments locally because of that. And there's no guarantee that they would have gotten that from their general education. That's a whole other story that we won't go into. Which is why we then started to work in secondary schools. Transition year is an easy, primary schools are relatively easy to get into. They have a little bit of flexibility. You know, a teacher, if they're interested, will welcome it. Secondary schools can be harder, you know, they're very focused on exam, apart from transition year. And essentially our OTBO secondary, it's the same thing. It's we take them through this exploratory journey of their place, landscape, built natural cultural heritage, community, conservation. But we really up the content a little and ask them pretty serious questions about the past, the present and the future for their place and get them to think about it. What's going to happen if we continue to do this, or how would you like this to be into the future? And it's assessed through personal reflective journals, which can be really actually moving to receive them back, to see these 15 and 16 year olds at day one are like, my place is boring, I hate it, I can't wait to get out of here. And after 10 weeks or however we structure the programme, they're saying, it's amazing, I can't believe this was here, and you know, I hope to be able to do something positive into the future. So that concept of encouraging critical thinking, it's one of the buzzwords, you know, but it is important that it's not just content dump, it's asking questions and facilitating that. And like I mentioned, the active stewardship part of it is really important too, and that's the empowering part, that you can ask all those questions, but also then sometimes come up with an answer, that you can actually do something rather than sit back and wait for others to do it. We also provide training to other people who are interested in place-based learning, just again, you know, identifying a need. We were just being hounded by people basically, so we do deliver Department of Education approved summer training for teachers, primary teachers, which is really nice. And we do a learning landscape symposium in March, which is all about this concept of using your place, learning from, about and for your place. And we have people from all over Ireland and now internationally coming to engage with this. What's been really nice with the teacher training course is we set it up for teachers, which is fine, but now I'd say over half of our participants are community leaders, people who want to engage their local community, not within the formal education system, but a little bit more broadly. So that's coming up at the start of July, which is a nice one as well. A really, really important programme within what we're doing, one of our cornerstones probably, is our heritage walks. For the first Sunday of the month, every month since 2008. I think we cancelled 3 times for weather, and it was serious weather. It's, you know, it has to be pretty extreme for us to cancel. We have had a local heritage walk, and it works on a few levels. You know, you get to see parts of your place that maybe aren't always publicly accessible. What's really nice though is to see community leaders coming out from that system. So at the start, you know, it was, as you probably, everybody might, it was, we went to the standard expert, the person with the doctor in front of their name or whatever it was that worked in a university somewhere. But then it became more and more apparent that on these walks, the community and the people that were attending knew just as much and often more than the person who was leading. So what we have now is a situation where we've local farmers, we've local enthusiasts, people who have maybe volunteered on archaeological digs and want to share their information, approaching us saying, I'd like to lead a walk. We just, you know, say, that's grand. We advertise it, they turn up and they lead it. So it's a really nice, and it's place-based learning 100% in action. These farmers get to show off the work that they have done in protecting their place and, you know, get some recognition for it. Alongside that, in the winter months, we have community tea talks, and that's a very deliberate, not community heritage talks, because As with a lot of our events, the social element is as important, if not sometimes more important. So we had a disused community, well, relatively disused community hall in Tubber, and we started going there, and we give the kettle on from 7:30, the talk starts at 8:00, and they're there from 7:15, waiting to come in, no matter what the talk. And it's also, it's been an opportunity to share research that's been done, which has been great, but also to celebrate local people. So just to, you know, if somebody has an interesting story or they've done something, to give that platform. But like I said, it's about a community gathering and building and also learning while they're doing it. Which is another element of the conservation volunteers. Over 300 registered each year. We get about 100 or so people out on events. Rebuilding stone walls, litter picks, getting volunteering on local archaeological digs, monitoring bat maternity roost sites, cutting scrub. There's a whole range of different conservation activities, each one of them led by somebody who has information on that particular activity, obviously. So there is a learning element, upskilling again, and again, huge community building. So this is a community within a community. I seem to be saying community a lot, but really it's all about community. And there was mention of celebration, and I think it's really, really, really important. And we have two big community celebrations. We've just had Burn and Bloom, which celebrates the return of the Burn flora in May. And then in the October bank holiday weekend, we have the Winteridge weekend. So in the Burn, we do our farming a little bit backwards, that we put the cattle into the uplands for the winter, and most places take them down. So acknowledging and celebrating that tradition and that you know, rich cultural heritage around it. We have moved to different communities within the region over the years, and the community take on to do whatever it is they want to do. It's brilliant to move because you get competition between communities. So if Karen did it well last year, Ballyvaughan are going to do it twice as well this year. And we have a community cattle drive and walks, talks, but anything basically that the local people want to celebrate and show off. And we just do the advertising and that kind of side of things. So that's what we're at. And I just wanted to maybe leave you, I suppose, with a few of the practical, really simple, the stuff that we do in schools. And you probably are using this stuff anyway, but just to give you a more, I know, practical idea of what it is I'm talking about. Really simple activity. It was the Irish Landscape Alliance. I read about it. Terry O'Regan put it together. Just to look at your OS map, to get children, anybody, to look at their OS map, to see what's there. We do in rural areas, a 3-kilometre circle, a 1-kilometre circle in urban areas is what they reckon people can kind of cope with, and just get them to create your own legend of what it is you know and don't know about your local place. It's amazing, and it's also kind of upsetting that there are things, I don't know, 500 metres down the road from people that they don't know about. So that's a really nice, simple activity. Connected with that, there are so many online resources available everywhere. So we use heritage maps a lot to look at the local monuments, to find information about them, to add to the content that we've got from the OS map. And again, you know, when we have kids in the Burn that know more about Newgrange than what's in their local fields, you know, that's kind of what we're trying to come up against and to work towards, I suppose. I'm sure you're all very familiar with it, but again, the school's folklore collection on the Dúchas website, so it's about finding ways that people will relate to their places. So it might be true story and folklore and legend, that might be the hook that gets them engaged. So we would look at the local stories. Alongside that, we would look at, obviously, the census records. So we've all of these resources available. The National Biodiversity Data Centre, to try to find out a little bit more about your local biodiversity, is really, really nice. They create a spreadsheet for a 1 or 2 kilometre or 10 kilometre square area of what's been recorded. And then another really nice activity that we do to try to engage people with built heritage, rather than it being a point and talk tour. If we're bringing people out to a site, we go in advance and take 10, 15 interesting pictures. So the points that you might choose to point at if you were going to do a point and talk, take the pictures, create a really little easy map, give them then the pictures when they get in there, allow them to discover the place, to find the pictures and mark on the map where they are. And then as you're going around, they're more invested and they're like, oh, number one is over here, number two is over here. And you get to tell them the story anyway, but it's a little bit more interactive. Or similarly, kind of the reverse of that, this is a map, this is actually where our office is, and we have clues related to each of these points of interest on our road. You send them out with the clues and the map and get them to try to look at it. And again, critically thinking about what could that clue possibly relate to, what structure or building that is. And then you can, you know, give the information as required. So that's essentially what we're about, what we've been doing, why we do it. Because we think that, you know, as I said at the start, we're a conservation organisation. We're trying to get to a point of sustainable heritage conservation, but through engaged communities. So that's, it's community-led conservation rather than a top-down approach. And essentially, you know, the third kind of rung on that is that they have to be communities that live and make a living in these places. So it's not conservation, put a fence around it and that's it. It's acknowledging that it's evolving and that people use these places in different ways and take different meaning from them. We are at a point now where we're 10 years in and we are got models that are totally transferable, and we would like to and are looking to, if we have increased capacity, hopefully at some stage, share this widely with anybody that's interested. So if it is something that you'd like to know more about, or, you know, you'd like specifics on anything that we're doing, all of the details are on our website, and please do get in touch. And that's us. Thank you very much.